Father, again, we bow before you with thankful hearts and minds. We thank you, Lord, that we have this privilege of knowing the true and living God. Thank you, Lord, for caring enough about us to not leave us lost in sin, but, oh God, for searching us out and offering forgiveness, peace, hope, your salvation, a life with you. Father, we pray that as we are gathered here in your name, that our minds might be fastened upon you. May our hearts rejoice because of you. And we ask these things in your name. Amen. I want us to share together this morning from Ezekiel chapter 1. Ezekiel chapter 1. As you can probably see, the title of the message, "While Among the Exiles, the Heavens Opened." Let's begin reading in the first verse. "In the 30th year, in the fourth month, on the fifth day, while I was among the exiles by the Kibar River, the heavens were opened, and I saw visions of God. On the fifth month, it was the fifth year of the exile of King Jehoiakim, the word of the Lord came to Ezekiel the priest, the son of Buzi, by the Kibar River in the land of the Babylonians. There the hand of the Lord was upon me." Boy, you guys are probably thinking, wow, what is all of this? Is that what you're thinking? Yeah, okay. "I looked and I saw a windstorm coming out of the north, an immense cloud with flashing lightning and surrounded by brilliant light. The center of the fire looked like glowing metal, and in the fire was what looked like four living creatures. In appearance, their form was that of a man, but each of them had four faces and four wings. Their legs were straight. Their feet were like those of a calf and gleamed like burnished bronze. Under their wings, on their four sides, they had the hands of a man, and all four of them had faces and wings, and their wings touched one another. Each one went straight ahead, and they did not turn as they moved. Their faces looked like this. Each of the four had the face of a man on the right side. Each had the face of a lion, on the left the face of an ox, and each also had the face of an eagle. Such were their faces. Their wings were spread out upward. Each had two wings, one touching the wing of another creature on either side, the two wings covering its body. And each one went straight ahead, and wherever the spirit would go, they would go, without turning as they went. The appearance of the living creatures was like burning coals of fire or like torches. Fire moved back and forth among the creatures. It was bright and lightning flashed out of it. The creatures sped back and forth like flashes of lightning. As I looked at the living creatures, I saw a wheel on the ground beside each creature with its four faces. This was the appearance and structure of the wheels. They sparkled like chrysolite, and all four looked alike. Each appeared to be made like a wheel intersecting a wheel, that is, at right angles. And as they moved, they would go in any one of the four directions the creatures faced. The wheels did not turn about as the creatures went. Their rims were high and awesome. And all four rims were full of eyes all around. And when the living creatures moved, the wheels beside them moved. And when the living creatures rose from the ground, the wheels arose also. Wherever the spirit would go, they would go, and the wheels would rise along with them, because the spirit of the living creatures was in the wheels. And when the creatures moved, they also moved. When the creatures stood still, they also stood still. And when the creatures rose from the ground, the wheels rose along with them, because the spirit of the living creatures was in the wheels. And spread out above the heads of the living creatures was what looked like an expanse, sparkling like ice and awesome. Under the expanse, their wings were stretched out one toward the other, and each had two wings covering its body. And when the creatures moved, I heard the sound of their wings like the roar of rushing waters, like the voice of the Almighty, like the tumult of an army. And when they stood still, they lowered their wings. Then there came a voice from above the expanse over their heads as they stood with lowered wings. Above the expanse over their heads was what looked like a throne of sapphire. And high above on the throne was a figure like that of a man. I saw that from what appeared to be his waist up. He looked like glowing metal as full of fire. And that from there down he looked like fire and brilliant light surrounded him. Like the appearance of a rainbow in the clouds on a rainy day, so was the radiance around him. This was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of the Lord. And when I saw it, I fell face down and I heard the voice of one speaking. Wow. How would you like to see something like that? Probably. How many of you have ever been really scared? Ever really been scared? Ezekiel was really scared by what he saw. It scared him. As we see Ezekiel's vision of God, numerous topics of importance are truly addressed in the Bible. In fact, we've mentioned some. The Bible addresses aspects of personal relationships. It may be that of marriage and family life. It may be that of friendships or the treatment of those people with special needs, or perhaps even our work relationships, employer-employee relationships. The Bible talks about all of these and many other. It deals with personal integrity, of pain, of suffering and death. How to live in gentleness and peace, how to manage our money. The Bible shares with us God's point of view and his advice and counsel to us on all of these subjects, and all of them are important to us. And understanding and endeavoring to live by the perspectives of the Bible on these topics are of great value. However, what God revealed about himself in Ezekiel chapter 1 is important for us to comprehend. Even though it seems strange, in fact, I was reading about the Jewish rabbis in ancient times. They did not recommend that their priests, their young priests, read Ezekiel until they had a lot more experience. But don't let that worry you. Because God has this revelation, this account of Ezekiel's vision in this book for a good reason. And I hope that we can discover the reason for that this morning. Ezekiel, we're told, was a priest. And he was now, it says, in the 30th year. That is, he was 30 years old. And you know what that meant? Well, at the age of 30, the Israelite men were to begin serving in their priestly capacity. That is, if they were descendants of Aaron, and also of Levi in particular, the Levites, they were to serve between the ages, beginning at age 30 through the age 50. They were to serve. We read about that in Numbers chapter 4, and we've left some verses there if you want to look those up later on. But Ezekiel is now 30, and what does that mean? Well, it means that if he had been in Israel and in Jerusalem, he would now begin serving his priestly ministry. But you know where he was? He wasn't there. He wasn't even near there. In fact, for 5 years now, Ezekiel had been one of those who had been carried away in captivity from his homeland, and he was living in Babylon. Now, how was he going to be serving those priestly duties, the functions of taking care of the temple, when he was nowhere near it? Perhaps he was disappointed. But God introduces himself once again to Ezekiel in his visions. As Landon Dowden stated in his commentary on this passage, seeing God clearly, and I want you to really pay attention to this, seeing God clearly allows us to see everything else rightly, including ourselves. If you don't have an understanding of who God is, then things will not go right in your life. You will make decisions that are not good decisions. The more you understand who God is, the more you're going to be able to trust Him, and the more you're going to want to follow Him. But what can we learn from God from Ezekiel's encounter in his vision? Well, there's a few things that I want to point out. First of all, and there's more, but there's at least four things that are very important for us to know. God is not confined, He is not confused, or He is not confounded by our circumstances. He is not confined by our location. There were many of those who had been carried away captive. Here they are, away from the temple. They thought, okay, we're away from our God. Our God, you see, we try to put God in a little box somewhere, don't we? You say, oh no, Pastor, I don't do that. I know God's everywhere. Oh, really? If you know that, do you practice that in how you live? Are we living like we know that God is everywhere and that He isn't limited to where we are? You see, because sometimes we limit Him. We think, oh, the Lord's here today. He's with us, and He has promised to meet with us. Where two or three are gathered in His name, there He says, I'll be in the midst of you. But what about when we're not in here? What about when we're not gathered together with a group of other believers, or even two or three other believers? Is God not present? Is God somehow confined in working in our lives and helping us when we have a need? Is He limited by our location? You say, oh, it's so hard at school. It's so hard to be a Christian because there's not very many of us who are, and it's so difficult. Is God not there with you as a believer? Is He limited? What about the work site? Oh, you don't understand my boss, or you don't understand this individual that I have to work with all the time. Is God limited by the location or the people around you? God is not confined, and you see, that's the title. While among the exiles, the heavens opened. While he was away, God is not confused by our situation. He knows everything about us. He isn't puzzled. I have to tell you, there's times when I'm puzzled. There's times when I'm not sure about exactly what to do, and I have to seek the wisdom of God and His counsel to help me understand, what do I do? How should I respond? But God's never been confused, and God's always been able to give me an answer, because God's never confused about our circumstances. He knows. You say, well, you know, I just lost my job. I'm having a difficult time, or I've just experienced this. I'm having a trouble. God's not confused. He's not confused by those circumstances. He's not confounded by our limitations. You know, there's things that you and I are not able to do. We are limited creatures, aren't we? Even things that you and I would like to do, sometimes we can't do. Even things we used to be able to do, we can't do. And you think, how could God possibly use me? Remember, here was a man who wanted to be used of God. He was a priest. He was just beginning, or should have been just beginning, his ministry. And now he's in a place, a location, and a situation, and he seems limited. But God appears to him to let him know that he is not confined, confused, or confounded by our circumstances. Second thing I want us to notice that we learn from this passage is God speaks to us. In verse 3, it says, the word of the Lord came to Ezekiel, the priest. You know, in every church that I have pastored, you know where the pulpit is? It isn't over here. It isn't over here. It's here. You know why? Because God's word needs to be the focus of his people. His truth needs to be at the forefront of our gathering. Because it is his word that is a light unto our path. It is his word that can keep us from stumbling into sin. And so, if you wonder, I hope perhaps now you'll wonder, you know, every time you look up here and you see the pulpit here, that's why it's here and not over here or over there. It's because this is where the word comes forth. Now, God took the initiative. God began the conversation. Here Ezekiel is. He, along with other exiles, are down by this river, which was in the vicinity of Babylon. And God gives him a word. God takes the initiative. Do you know that none of us are here because of our own initiative? Not one of us. When I came to know the Lord Jesus, it wasn't because of the initiative that I took. I remember as a young child, there was a pastor at a Nazarene church, and they had a Bible school. And he drove a little, what I call a slug bug. You know what that is? A little Volkswagen. And it was an automatic, which was kind of unusual. Because when I was a kid, most vehicles were not automatic, transmission-wise. But I remember he would come by and he picked up, and he'd load a few kids up in that little slug bug, and I was one of them. I was only about four or five years old. And he'd come by and pick us up, take us to Bible school. And, you know, that wasn't my initiative. That was God's initiative. One day, he had to tell my mother something. She is standing out on the front porch, and he walked up to tell her. He left that little slug bug running. I went down in there and jumped in the driver's seat and pulled it down and drive. Now, I couldn't reach the floor, you know, so I couldn't reach the gas pedal, so it was moving along like this. He'd come running. God took the initiative. When I was 7 years old, in the same congregation, I was sitting one night, I believe it was a Tuesday night, in the second pew, about where Butch is right now, or Joanne, in the church. And my Sunday school teacher was sitting next to me. And the evangelist preached a message. And you know what it was? I wasn't planning on going up and getting saved. I didn't come there with that intent. But God found me there. God took the initiative. And he spoke to me through his word. And he said, you need to repent. You, if you were to die in your sins, would meet my judgment. You would go to hell. God took the initiative so that I didn't need to die in my sins. God took the initiative to say, Jay, get out of there. Get down to that altar and come to me. God took the initiative to speak to us and to call us by name. And God is still speaking today. The book of Hebrews says, in the past, God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets and many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by the word of his power. God is speaking to us today through Jesus Christ and his word. The next slide we just added in, just to kind of give you maybe at least someone's visual picture of some of the things that Ezekiel saw. We see the wheel inside a wheel with eyes all around it. And these wheels didn't have to turn anyway because the way they were designed, they could move in any direction without turning around or going in a circle. It wasn't like that truck driver who said, give me 40 acres and I'll turn this rig around. He didn't need that. The same thing with the cherubim. We notice another thing. Not only is God not troubled by our needs, he is not limited. Not only does God speak and take the initiative to do so, but God is all-powerful and all-wise. And that's what is being shown here in these living creatures. These living creatures, by the way, are identified in Ezekiel chapter 10 as cherubim. The first time we meet cherubim in the Bible is in Genesis. When Adam and Eve sinned and God says, get out of the garden and you're not coming back. Cherubim stood there with flaming swords to guard the way so that they could not go back in and eat of the tree of life and live forever in sin. But the four living creatures have four faces, one in each direction. I guess you could say you can't do anything behind their back. The same was true with the wheels, by the way. They had eyes all around the rims of the wheels. So whichever direction they were facing, they could see. They could see. God is all wise. He knows everything. They sped back and forth like flashes of lightning, indicating that time and space were no matter to God. You can imagine a flash of lightning. Ezekiel then saw those four wheels, and each one appeared to be made like wheels intersecting. God is all powerful and all wise. We can't go where he can't see. But you know, that may be scary if you're not living for God, if you don't know him. But it is a great comfort to those who know him to know that God is aware. He knows our every experience. He knows everything about us. God knows things about you you don't even imagine about yourselves. The final thing I think is important for us to know, that God is unique. Isaiah wrote, in fact, if you'd been in our adult Bible class this morning, you would have read these verses or heard them read. Isaiah said that he is unique. Listen to his words. This is what the Lord says. Israel's King and Redeemer, the Lord Almighty, I am the first and I am the last. Apart from thee, there is no God. Who then is like me? Let him proclaim it. And just for you to maybe make a little note there in Isaiah, listen, John saw the risen, glorified Jesus. And this is what Jesus said. Jesus said to him, I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is, who was, and who is to come, the Almighty. By the way, isn't Jesus claiming that he's God? So either he's a liar or he is what he says he is. You can mark that down. God is unique. If you'll notice in the vision that Ezekiel had, despite, I don't know about you, but how many of you have ever heard of Sasquatch? Wouldn't you like to meet, if there really is a Sasquatch, wouldn't you like to come up on him sometime when you're traipsing around the woods? Oh yeah, some of you would, but it might be a little scary if he's really what he says, what they say he is. It'd be kind of like coming up on a grizzly bear, you know. It'd be scary. But imagine, because this vision that Isaiah saw was as realistic as if you and I come upon a grizzly bear in the woods. It was frightening. It was real. And yet, and look, did you read the descriptions of these creatures? But it says then, and spread out above the heads of the living creatures was what looked like an expanse sparkling like ice and awesome. Then there came a voice from above the expanse over their heads as they stood with lowered wings. Above the expanse over their heads was what looked like a throne of sapphire. And high above on the throne was a figure like that of a man. And I saw that from what appeared to be his waist up, he looked like glowing metal as if full of fire. And that from there down he looked like fire, and brilliant light surrounded him like the appearance of a rainbow in the clouds on a rainy day. So was the radiance around him, and this was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of the Lord. Don't assume that God is what you imagine him to be like. One of the great problems we have in our world today, even among many who are young Christians, is that they have imagined what God is like, and they haven't really listened to what God has told us about himself. For example, some people say, well, you know, my God wouldn't do that because he is a God of love. He wouldn't judge anyone. He wouldn't cause them to be condemned. Oh, really? And where did you get that God? You didn't get it from the Bible. You see, that God is so just that in order to demonstrate and give his love toward us, he had to step down from heaven and climb up on a cross and pay for our sins. If he hadn't done that, God could not be just in forgiving us. He, the judge, came off and around from the judge, and he got on the cross to pay for our sins. Don't assume that God is what you imagine him to be. The God of the Bible created you. He is not a creature of your imagination. Notice that God is above all else. His throne is over all of these others. He is awesome and inexhaustible. He is not the man upstairs. What Ezekiel envisioned was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of the Lord. That is, he saw a manifestation of God, not the essence of God. The Bible tells us, in fact, Moses, God told Moses that he was going to let him see something of his glory. He did not see his essence. He saw something of his glory. And he said, you can't look upon my face. In other words, you can't see the true essence and radiance of God. Why? Because you couldn't live. You remember the eclipse and how we were cautioned to be sure that we had our eyes protected as we looked at it, because it could damage our eyes to look that way if they were unprotected. Imagine getting close to the sun. How close would we have to be to the sun before we would just disintegrate, be burnt up? Huh? The sun's not even a candle in the glory of the essence of God who made it. And so God allows us to see enough of him and his glory that we can know him and learn to love him and serve him and appreciate him. And notice Ezekiel is careful here to use the words like a throne, the appearance of the likeness of a man, the likeness of the glory of the Lord. John says, John 1:18, no one has seen God, but God the one and only, who is at the Father's side, has made him known. Now notice Ezekiel's response, and I want to close with this. Ezekiel said, when I saw it, I fell face down, and I heard the voice of one speaking. It'd be good if we could get into that, but that's the next few chapters, so we're not going to have time to do that. But the prophet Isaiah had a similar reaction when he glimpsed the glory of God. He says, woe is me, for I am undone. I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. Saul of Tarsus, later known as the Apostle Paul, had a life-transforming experience when he saw the glory and the brightness of the risen Christ. John the Apostle, who when Jesus was ministering, sat at his side. He was one of the small band, the three whom was really the closest to Jesus when he ministered in the world. But when John saw the revelation of the risen, glorified Jesus, the great I Am, the Alpha and the Omega, He fell down as dead. He saw the awesomeness of God. I want to ask you this. Do you know this God? This God who is not limited or disabled by your circumstances. This God who has spoken to us, revealing His desire to save us from our sins and to bring us into His fellowship. Do you know this God who is all wise and all powerful, and He can help us understand and know what to do and when to do it? This God who is unlike anything else that we've ever known or experienced or could experience. This God who loved you so much that despite His awesomeness, He came to pay for your sins and mine. Let's pray. Oh Father, we've looked into a passage that is difficult, but Lord, one that reveals to us a glimpse of your glory. I pray, Lord, that we might truly get a sense of your awesomeness. That we might reach out to you as you have reached to us. And that our response might be one of reverence and yet trust and obedience. I ask it in your name. Amen.